walking through the book of Acts. And this morning we come to Acts chapter 3, taking a look at verses 11 through 26. If you're using the Pew Bible, you can find this on page 911. So I ask you please take out your scripture text and turn there to Acts chapter 3. Again, we're looking at verses 11 through 26. Before we actually read and hear God's word preached, let's go to our Lord and Savior and ask He to illumine our hearts and minds, so we might rightly receive that which He has for us. Please join me in prayer. Lord God, we do come before You. We thank You and praise You, Lord, that You reveal Yourself in a mighty way through Your word. We thank You, Lord, as we open Your text and hear it read and preached. We are lifted up heavenward to see Christ and see Him highly exalted. So, Lord, we ask You might do that this morning. Lord, help us to see how we too can be healed by turning and trusting in Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask You to be with me, Your servant. Let the truths that lead my mouth, Lord, be Your word. Help me, Lord, the truths You place there for the edifying of Your people, for turning hearts to Yourself. Lord, I ask You to be with each and every one who's sitting under the preaching of Your word. Use it, Lord, to truly encourage and to convict, to turn hearts to Yourself, to build up in holiness and comfort, so that Christ might be highly exalted and He might be praised. We ask this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. So Acts chapter 3, beginning again in verse 11. Hear now God's holy, inerrant, and infallible word. While He clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them in the portico called Solomon's. And when Peter saw it, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us, as though by our own power or piety we have made Him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified His servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he decided to release Him. But you denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And His name, by faith in His name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given this man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that as Christ would suffer, He thus fulfilled. Repent, therefore, and turn back, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that He may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive in the time for restoring all things about which God spoke by the mouth of His holy prophets long ago. Moses said, "The Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. You shall listen to him in whatever he tells you. And it shall be that every soul who does not listen to that prophet shall be destroyed from the people." And all the prophets who have spoken, from Samuel to those who came after him, also proclaimed these things. You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God made with your fathers, saying to Abraham, "And in your offspring shall all the families of earth be blessed." God, having raised up his servant, sent him to you first to bless you, by turning every one of you from your wickedness. You ever see something that amazes you? Something that just astounds you? Like maybe a David Copperfield illusion or a Bill Henry magic trick? When you see this, aren't you prone to ask how? How did you do this? What's the secret? What's the trick? Tell me, I want to know. And we see the same sort of thing whenever somebody is miraculously healed. How does cancer just disappear? How did your diabetes suddenly get better? We want to know how. And that's what we see in our text this morning. People wanting to know how. Because we're coming off the heels of this lame beggar being healed, and people are rushing to ask, how did this happen? And through the text this morning, through our message, you're going to see how this lame beggar was healed, but you're also going to see how you too can be healed. I want you to follow along the flow of the passage because you're going to see how it develops. You're going to see first how you mess up. Second, how Christ cleans up. And he does this so third, you receive your reward. And this brings us to the point of the message, which is the point of the text. Get this down. Hear this, let it resonate and sink into your hearts and minds. Christ Christ heals you by turning you from sin to Him. So first, you mess up. You ever do something that you thought was really a good decision, the right move, only to later determine it was horribly wrong? You made this huge mistake. Maybe you're looking at something on the shopping network or on a computer, and you go, wow, this seems like a great deal. I gotta get this. So you buy it. And what happens? You find out you didn't get at all what you thought you were getting. You realize you messed up. And you know what? That's what we see going on our text this morning. How sometimes you may even have the best of intentions, but you realize too late that you messed up. You see, Peter is making this point clear in this, his second sermon, as the people are rushing to him to find out, how did this healing take place? See, they're rushing to him because they're amazed at what they've seen. They're astounded. Look at verse 11. Look what it says. While he clung to Peter and John, all the people, utterly astounded, ran together to them in a portico called Solomon's. You've got this mob scene rushing towards Peter, John, and this lame man with one thing on their mind. They want to know how. How did this happen? How did you heal this lame man? And it's in this that you see how you mess up. You mess up by choosing wrongly. You see, you choose wrongly when you look at the wrong things or the wrong person to find your hope or your healing. When you turn to your job or your son or your daughter or your mother or your father or your friend and find your happiness or hope there, well, guess what? You're messing up because you're looking in the wrong direction at the wrong person. That's what you see going on here. Because what are this crowd, what are they doing? Who are they looking at? They're looking at Peter and John and saying, how did you heal this man? They think that they're the source of the healing. So what does Peter do? He answers. And look what he does. Look at verse 12. Because he's going to make clear here how whenever you choose anything over Christ, you mess up. Verse 12, Peter asks. He begins his sermon. Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made this man walk? See, Peter's saying, don't look at us. You're making a mistake if you think we did it. They want to know, how did they heal this lame man? So Peter's making clear, it wasn't us. It was God Himself. And why did God bring about this healing? So that His servant, His Son, Jesus Christ, might receive the glory. You see that language in verse 13 where it says His servant? You know what that's referring to? That's Isaiah 53 language where Christ is the suffering servant. God's chosen Messiah who was sent to suffer and die on the cross so you might be healed. And that's what Peter's pointing the people to. That's what he's explaining. And he's showing how they messed up because they had the opportunity to choose Jesus, but they rejected Him and chose Barabbas. Verse 13, look what it says. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified His servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he had decided to release him. See, Peter's answer to their question, how, is the one who you rejected. This Jesus that you could have chose, that you said, no, we don't want him, that's how this man was healed. And he's showing right there how you mess up by not choosing Jesus. See, Pilate gave them a choice. He said to all the people as they crowded around, he said, who shall I release to you, Barabbas or Jesus? Who do you want? Do you want this murderer who shed blood, or do you want the one who shed his blood for you? And who did the people choose? The murderer. They chose Barabbas. They chose death over life. And verses 14 to 15 make this clear. You denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. Right there you're seeing Peter say, Jesus Christ heals you and brings you life, but you killed him. Because you chose death over life. And you know what? You too choose death over life every time you choose someone or something over Jesus Christ. In this life, you realize you're always faced with choices. But no matter what choice you're faced with, it always comes down to a choice of one of two things. It's either Jesus Christ or something else. Either Jesus Christ or someone else. And if you choose anything other than Jesus Christ, anyone other than Jesus Christ, guess what you do? You choose wrongly and you mess up. When you choose work over worship, you mess up. When you choose to go the way of the world over the way of Christ, you mess up. Because Christ is the one you want to choose always. And this is because only Jesus Christ has the power to heal you. Do you realize that? That's where your salvation comes, from Christ and Him alone. It's through the name of Jesus Christ that you find the healing that you truly need. That's what Peter's driving home in verse 16. In His name, by faith in His name, has this man been made strong whom you see and know. See, right here you're seeing the power that the name of Jesus Christ brings with it. And I want you to see something. You may have missed it, but it's not faith that heals. That's not what Peter just said, is it? See, many people, they make the mistake of seeing that hyphenated phrase, faith in His name. They make the mistake of taking that to mean it's your faith that heals you. That's a disastrous thought to have. You know why? Because that puts the hope of your salvation squarely on your shoulders. You know what a burden that is to carry? To think that you're responsible for your own salvation, your own healing. When you think that way, you're moving into a works theology, which, as you saw last week, brings you into the wall that never heals you, but only cripples you. See, often people think that they have it within themselves, the power lies within to do better, try harder, make better choices, and then things will go right. But that's never the case, is it? Because it's always Jesus Christ. Unfortunately, though, we often choose poorly because, as they say, hindsight is 20/20. You know what that means? Foresight is not 20/20, is it? Our sight gets better after we mess up. And that's what you see going on here in our text. That people are coming now to see through Peter's sermon how they should have made a different choice. They should have screamed out the name of Jesus when Pilate said, "Who do you want me to release to?" They should have said Jesus rather than crucify Him. And that's because it's the name of Jesus Christ that brings healing. And what Peter's doing here is highlighting the value of the name of Jesus. See, there's value in a name. You understand this, right? Don't you go to great lengths to preserve your good name? Didn't you tell your children, "Don't do this, you're going to ruin our name"? Don't you understand that when your name is ruined, so is your word and your reputation? Things are made so much harder. So people go to great lengths to preserve their name because they understand that a name can carry with it strength, can carry with it integrity, it can carry with it confidence. And that's what Peter's saying the name of Christ does. Because it's only the name of Jesus Christ that saves you. Hear that again. It's only the name of Jesus Christ that saves you. So it's not faith in His name, but it's His name. And you see this clearly how Peter concludes verse 16. Look what he says. The faith that is through Jesus has given this man his perfect health in the presence of you all. Focus on that language that you saw right there, through Jesus. Because with that language, Peter is making clear, faith doesn't save you. Jesus Christ does. Faith is the intended human response to the monergistic work of God in your life. See, it's what flows from the work that God does. Think of faith this way. It's like the cheer that erupts after your team wins the World Series because your favorite player hit that grand slam. When he comes up the bat and you're down by two runs, you're cheering. You're saying, "Hit a home run, hit, do something, get a score," right? But your cheering doesn't cause the home run, does it? No, it's the ball flying over the fence that causes you to jump up in this maniacal screaming and cheering, "Yes, we won!" That's what happens. The home run elicits a response, and in the same way, God's work in your heart elicits a response of faith. It flows from the work that He does. It causes you to repent so that you can be cleaned up. See, because Christ is the one that cleans up your mess. See, this is important to understand that you messed up. Because when you recognize you mess up, it tells you that you've got a mess that needs to be cleaned up. Which brings us to our second point. Christ cleans up. Peter makes clear how the Jews and the people messed up big time by choosing Barabbas over Jesus. And what's interesting about Peter's words here, his language, it almost seems like he's letting the people off the hook a bit. Almost like he's saying, you know what? It's not really your fault because you acted foolishly. Look at verse 17. Look what he says here. And now, brothers, you acted in ignorance, as did your rulers. You can hear those words and almost say to yourself, oh, you know what? It's not so bad. If I mess up, it's not that big a deal. I was just being foolish, a little mistake. But that's not what Peter's saying here. He's not excusing your sin. He's not saying your ignorance is a defense. What he's pointing out is the same thing that Jesus himself said on the cross in Luke 23:34. Remember the words he uttered. What did he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It's the same language that Paul himself says in 1 Corinthians 2:8 when he writes, none of the rulers of this age understood who Christ was. For if they had, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. So what's Peter, Paul, and Christ all getting at here? The importance of the Spirit being poured out. See, before the Spirit was poured out, people didn't understand properly. So in one way, they kind of had an excuse because they didn't understand fully. That didn't account for their sin. They were still responsible, but it didn't come to justify it a little bit. But you know what that says for you? You don't have the same excuse, do you? Because you've got God's Word written down in the Scripture reading so that you know better. And you've got God's Spirit that indwells you so you can understand it properly. You don't need to be foolish. You don't need to rush into mistakes because you've got God's Word and His Spirit to guide you. So what this says is, you can properly understand what God would have you do if you just pick up your Bibles and read them. Come into worship and hear His Word preached. Know who Jesus is and what He says about what you're to do. You want to do this so that you don't mess up. Whatever you're going through, whatever situation you're dealing with, even right now, you've got a choice before you. So before you choose, pick up the Bible and read it. Spend some time in prayer. Ask your brothers and sisters in Christ. Because it's the truth as laid out in God's Word that helps you avoid making a big mess. Brothers and sisters, if you want to avoid acting in ignorance, then you need to be guided by Scripture. You need to let God's Word direct your steps. Because if not, you're bound to do stupid things. I mean, ask yourself, don't you usually mess up when you just rush into something without stopping and considering all the things that are before you? When you rush in to make a decision without even considering God's Word, not asking a fellow brother or sister, maybe even your pastor, what do you think I should do here? That's a recipe for messing up. You know that because you've done it. I've done it. Who of us hasn't done that? And what happens after you do that? Don't you kind of feel really defeated, really beaten down? How could I have done this again? But you don't need to be that way. See, that's what the law does to you. The law beats you down. But Christ, He cleans you up. He shows you the right path, the right way to go. And it's laid out in Scripture for you. And if you need help understanding, you can ask somebody. Just because you look at something and think it's the right way, check it with somebody else. Let the Spirit guide you. Maybe even do something crazy. Ask your elder. What do you think? Ask your pastor. Ask one of your deacons. You have financial difficulties? Don't think you figured it out yourself. Go to your deacon and say, hey, what do you guys got? Wisdom? What do you think here? See, God knows that you're going to mess up. That's why He sent His Son to clean up for you. Jesus Christ was sent with a purpose in mind to go to the cross to clean up your mess through His sacrificial atoning death. And guess what? God planned that from eternity past. That's what Peter's driving home in verse 18. But what God foretold by the mouth of all the prophets, that His Christ would suffer. See, that's what He foretold by all the prophets, His Christ would suffer. And Peter now says, He thus fulfilled. See, God knew the mess that you would make, so He sent His Son to clean it up. And this is why Jesus Christ is always the one to whom you want to look, the one to whom you want to run, because He's the one who died for your sins. And that means you want to be healed today? You want to be healed from your hurting hearts? Then confess your sin and turn to Christ. See, when you're walking with Christ, what you do is you confess your sin. Remember we said about confession of sin, how that's tied to repentance? What is repentance? It's a turning. It's the idea of walking in one direction, stopping in your tracks, turning around and walking the other way. See, that's what Christ enables you to do. That's what His Word enables you to do. You're walking in this direction and you see sin on the horizon, so you stop in your tracks, you repent, you turn around, and you go the other way. Even if it's not the way you think is right. Because if God says it's the right way, guess what? You may not understand it, but it's the right way to go. And when you do this, when you repent, you know what happens? Christ is showing you how He's cleaning you up. He makes your scarlet sin white as snow. That's what Peter's getting at verse 19 when he says, "Repent therefore and turn back," listen to this language, "that your sins may be blotted out." See, this language, blot out, it shows how Christ cleans you up, cleans up your mess. In Peter's day, people didn't write on paper. They wrote what was known as papyrus. And you know how you took care of whatever was on papyrus? You had to wipe it down. You had to clean it up. And when you did so, guess what happened? Everything that was on there was gone. It's kind of like writing in pencil. You know when you write something in pencil, what can you do? You can take an eraser and you can erase it. It's gone, right? You understand that. That's why we sign important legal contracts in pen, not in pencil. We don't want anyone to come along and erase it. But guess what? The mess that you made, it was written down in pencil because Jesus Christ comes and He erases it. He blots it out so it's remembered no more. Isn't that amazing news? Your sins are remembered no more because Jesus Christ blotted them out.
Amen.
That's exciting stuff. That's what He does. He wipes it away so there's not even a trace of it. Get that down because it tells you you are not defined by your sins, but you're known by your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Whatever sins you committed in the past, they're in the past. Christ died on the cross for them. So leave them back there. Don't drag them forth along with you.
Hallelujah.
Don't see yourself weighed down by them because Christ has cleaned up your mess by blotting out your sins.
Amen.
And guess what happens when your sins are blotted out? You can now come into God's presence. Until he was healed, that lame man, where did he lay? Outside the temple, outside of God's presence. But the minute that Jesus Christ healed him, cleaned him up, what did he do? He leapt to his feet and he went into the temple praising his God. Walked right into God's presence. And when Christ cleans you up, guess what that means? You get to come into his presence. And when you're in Christ's presence, guess what? You've got a time of refreshing before you.
Amen.
Because it removes your sin. Think about how sin leaves you feeling burdened and guilty, weighed down. Don't you carry around like this heavy load on your back? But you don't have to do that. You can repent and be refreshed by Christ's healing touch. Verse 20 says, it tells you why you want to repent. Look what it says. So that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Christ appointed for you. Right here, Peter's using eschatological language. Eschatological language is a fancy word for end times. What Peter's doing is, he's preaching the return of Jesus Christ. Just as Jesus Christ himself said, just as you saw back in Acts chapter 1, Christ is coming back on the clouds. He's going to return. Because Christ has been raised from the dead and ascended on high. He's sitting beside God in his glory. And you know what he's sitting there doing? Waiting to come back. Waiting to return to make everything new. To clean up all of creation. Just as the prophet said. This is what Peter's point is in verse 21. Whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all things about which God spoke by the mouth of his prophets long ago. This gives you a great impetus. It gives you what lies behind why you want to repent and turn to Christ. Because Christ is coming back. He's coming back for his final cleaning, as it were. You know when you sell a house, what do? Right before the new people move in? Don't you clean it like you never did before? Well, that's what Christ is coming back to do, to give it that final scrubbing, that final cleaning. And you know this because Moses already made this clear to you. Peter's turning to Deuteronomy 18:18-19 here to make clear that Jesus Christ is that promised Messiah. that promised prophet, the one who's going to be raised up to lead you into deliverance. That's what he says. God has placed the words in his mouth, and you need to listen to them. What does Jesus Christ give you? The very words of life. The words of healing. The words you need. So he's telling you right here that he's coming back, so now's the time to listen. Now's the time to turn from your sin and wickedness and follow after Jesus Christ. Because when he returns, it'll be too late. Listen now, so you don't perish tomorrow. Just as God sent Moses to lead the Israelites to deliverance, to lead them out of Egypt, so too he sent Jesus Christ, as that prophet he promised to raise up, to lead you out of your sin and into deliverance. To lead you right into your salvation. Verses 22 to 23, look what it says here. Moses said, "The Lord will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. You shall listen to him in whatever he tells you. And it shall be that every soul who doesn't listen to the prophet shall be destroyed from the people." Repent and turn to Jesus, and you won't be destroyed. So Peter's making clear, now's the time to listen. Which brings us to our third point. Receive your reward. Peter's urging his listeners, and you today, to not reject Christ's free gift of salvation. He's saying, walk away from your sin and turn to Jesus Christ. And what makes this so encouraging to hear is you know that you can do just this because it doesn't rest with you to do. Jesus Christ is the one who turns you around and enables you to walk along his paths. Isn't that amazing? That's what he does for you. That's how he heals you and cleans you up. He does it so you can follow him because he's the one that brings it about. Because he's your king. Think about that. When someone is your king, what does that mean? You serve him. You go where he says. You do what he says. You walk where he says to walk. Well, Jesus Christ is your king, and that's what you're seeing here by Peter mentioning Samuel. See, why did he mention Samuel? It kind of seems odd. It's like Samuel told you. All the prophets from Samuel. What he's doing here is drawing a connection between David and Jesus Christ. How is Samuel connected to David? Well, Samuel's the one who did what? Anointed David as God's chosen king. And who is David? The one that points forward to God's true king. His servant, his son, Jesus Christ. David's heir, your king, Jesus Christ. Verse 24 bears this out. Look what it says. And all the prophets who have spoken, from Samuel and those who came after him, also proclaimed these things. And what they're proclaimed, what they've proclaimed, is what's being proclaimed even right now. That you are all heirs of the promise. This is your promised reward. Jesus Christ turning you from your sin to him. He does this because of who you are. Because you're the seed of Abraham. You're his children, his sons and daughters, heirs of the covenant. And because you're heirs of the covenant, because you're God's own children, the promise is for you. Verse 25 says it like this. You're sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God made with your fathers, saying to Abraham, and in your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. I want you to note here the use of the singular. Notice what he did. Use the singular offspring. This is significant because it's showing you there's one person through whom you're blessed, and that's Jesus Christ. And you know this so clearly because Galatians 3:16 is your commentary on this passage. And what does Paul lay out there? He says the promises were made to Abraham and his offspring. And he says it doesn't say to offsprings as though there were many, but referring to one. And to your offspring, who is Jesus Christ. The promise made to Abraham and proclaimed by all the prophets was that Jesus Christ was the promised Messiah who came to bless you by turning you from all your wickedness and sin. This is what God had promised long ago, spoken through the prophets, and fulfilled through Jesus Christ. And the promised reward that Peter's emphasizing here is what you receive, your salvation. your eternity with your Lord and Savior. You won't perish in your sins because Jesus Christ turns you so you can receive your reward. He accomplishes for you what you could never do for yourself. Like this lame beggar who received new legs that could now walk, you too are healed by receiving a new heart. Your heart of stone is taken out, and you're given a heart of flesh. That's God's gift to you. And that's how you're blessed through Jesus Christ. Because through this, through Christ, you're turned away from your wickedness, away from your sin, and to Christ. Look at verse 26 says, God, having raised up his servant, sent him to you first to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness. Did you notice that very specific language that Peter uses here? He said, God raised up Jesus for you to turn all of you from your sin. You get that? God sent Jesus to turn you. It's not something you yourself do. He does it for you. And with this language, he's not talking about the resurrection. We know that when we look at the Greek, because he uses the Greek word anisthene, which means to stand up or be raised up. It's what you see in Deuteronomy, where God raised up Moses to lead the people out of Egypt. In the same way, he raised up Jesus, not to his resurrection, but raising him up to his birth, sending him to earth to die on this, in your place, so he could do what? Lead you to your deliverance. Lead you to your salvation. By leading you away from your sin and to him. This means there's no need for you to continue in your sin. You realize that? You don't have to sin. When you sin, it's a voluntary choice that you make. Nobody else causes you to sin because Christ has caused you to walk away from your sin. So unless they're more powerful than your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, guess what? They're not causing your sin. You're causing your sin because you're choosing wrongly. You're choosing to walk away from Christ when you don't need to. And when you do that, you know what you're doing? You're intentionally rejecting God's free gift that he's given to you. And that's ridiculous. Think about that. Who in their right mind would receive a free gift and say, no, I don't want it? This is like somebody coming to your house and saying, oh, I'm going to clean your house. And you say, no, get out. I want to clean my house myself. Why would you do that? Christ comes and cleans you up. Why would you say, no, I don't want you to do that. I want to do it myself. Think about being homeless, not having a house. So somebody buys you a house and says, here, I gave you a house you can live in. You say, no, I don't want it. Unless I can buy the house myself, I don't want it. That'd be insane, right? Well, it's the same way when you try to clean up yourself, thinking I'm going to do it on my own. Christ says you don't have to do that. He did it for you. He cleans you up as his gift to you.
Amen.
So receive his gift by repenting and receive your reward. I want you to think about something. I want you to think about being really sick. Having something like cancer or some other horrific disease where your prognosis is not very good. The doctor comes out with that long look on his face and he says, I'm sorry, but prognosis is not good. You're going to die. Think how that would weigh on you, what that would do to you. But imagine this, that in the waiting room, somebody says, hey, listen, buddy, come here. Sister, come here. There's this guy I know who had the exact same disease you have and he's now healed. Wouldn't you want to know how? How did that happen? Who healed him? Show me, tell me. That's what you want to do, right? Well, that's what Peter's making clear this morning. So let me make something clear to all of you. Hear me loud and clear. If you're here this morning, having never professed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then your prognosis is not very good. You're going to die in your sin and your trespasses. But you don't have to, because guess what? There are people who have been healed. And they're all around you. Ask them how. They'll tell you. Ask them, how did you get healed? Who healed you? And they will show you how you too can be healed. And if you're sitting here this morning thinking, that's not me, I've been healed by Jesus, don't rest so secure. Because you know that sin is still clinging to you. And it's prone to drag you away. You're prone to keep walking back towards your sin. So you need to continue relying on Christ, turning back to him time and time again. In this life, you face all kinds of choices, and we are so prone to choose wrong. We don't choose the things that enhance our faith, grow our spiritual health, but we're prone to choose the things like McDonald's french fries do. They taste so good, but they don't improve your health any better, do they? No. We do the same thing with our spiritual faith. We run to McDonald's instead of running to the church. So hear me loud and clear. You too can also still be healed each and every day because you've got sin in your own life and sin around you. You want to deal with it? Then turn to Jesus Christ. That's where you find your hope and your salvation. Brothers and sisters, hear this loud and clear. If you chase after Jesus Christ, always choose Him, then you're choosing what heals you. You're choosing who heals you, and you're showing others how you too can be healed. So make the right choices by always choosing Jesus. And do as Peter says, hear this, understand this, Christ heals you by turning you from sin to Him.
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord God, we do come before you. We thank you and praise you, Lord, that our faith does not rest in us, Lord, but it rests in the person and work of Jesus Christ, the one who you sent, Lord, your suffering servant, sent to suffer and pay the price for our sins. So, Lord, we ask that if there's any here this morning that knows you not, you might truly turn them this morning, Lord. Do a work in their heart that they might repent and turn to Jesus Christ. And, Lord, for those who are here who profess the name of Jesus, help them not to rest comfortably, Lord, but to recognize, even as you tell us in Philippians, we need to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Help them, Lord, to always make the choice of Jesus Christ. I pray that for each and every one of us, Lord, that we might truly be healed. We ask it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Let's respond to that by standing and saying to